today as we come to the table.
No matter how you present it, it only proves all the more that evidence and miracles do not a believer make. I said, you know, if only my family, if only my friends, if only the people at work could see a miracle, if only something great could happen, you know, then I would believe. And sometimes people even say, if I could see a miracle, then I would believe. You know, why doesn't God just show people miracles? Because he did, and they still didn't believe. The point is, if we choose not to believe, we're not going to believe regardless of what we see. But if our heart's soft, listen, if your heart is soft for the Lord, you don't need a miracle. You know him. You believe him.
Ever prayed or heard someone else say this prayer? God, if you'll just give me a sign, I'll believe. Now, while this seems logical, you have to remember that thousands of people encountered Jesus and witnessed his earthly miracles firsthand, yet many still didn't believe and even joined in the cries to crucify him. Well, thanks for staying with us today as we come to the table, the daily Bible study program of Pastor Mark Kirk of Calvary Knoxville. Well, we humans have stubborn, sinful hearts, don't we? God can bless us with a peaceful, comfortable life, and instead of turning to him in gratitude and devoting ourselves to him, as Pastor Mark will warn in today's message, we're more likely to grow complacent and make idols out of those comforts and conveniences. Now, let's join Pastor Mark in the book of John, chapter 11, as he begins his message entitled, Throwing Pearls to Swine.
Today we look at, in this last section of John chapter 11, throwing pearls to swine. As you guys know, we've been looking at the life of Lazarus and the resurrection of Lazarus and all that happened, even other things in John, but recently Lazarus and his resurrection. And today we're looking at throwing pearls to swine in relation to what happened to the resurrection of Lazarus. Jesus said this in Matthew 7:6, "Do not give what is holy to the dogs, nor cast your pearls before swine, lest they trample them under their feet and turn and tear you in pieces." This is a perfect description of what we're going to be looking at today as we finish chapter 11 and Lazarus. And that is this. Some people, when you give them the riches of God's word and the riches of the goodness of God, rather than receive it and say, yes, I want Jesus, I want to follow, isn't this great news? They openly reject it and they turn away from it, even no matter the evidence you present to them. No matter how you present the evidence, no matter how strong the evidence is, some people will receive the truth concerning the Lord with a soft and receptive heart. Others will reject it and reject him regardless of the evidence, no matter how you present it. Even a miracle of such power and visibility as seeing Lazarus raised from the dead, you would think, hey, if you were there and you saw somebody raised from the dead, you would certainly, everybody there would believe in Jesus. Now, they would believe a miracle was done, but it doesn't mean they would trust in Jesus. Why? Because some hearts are receptive and some hearts are not, and some hearts are not yet ready to be receptive. And so we have to wait on God's timing. But again, here's the thing. No matter how you present a situation, it's not always received well. It reminds me of this man who, his wife left town for a week or so for vacation. She had to travel somewhere without him, and so she had to reluctantly leave her favorite cat and her mom, who she was taking care of, with him. And he wasn't the most responsible, she felt like, so she was worried about leaving him there with them. Would he take care of them? Would he watch after them? What would happen? And so, again, she goes off, and a few days later, she's about 4 days into the trip. She thinks, I better call back and make sure everything's okay. So she calls back to her husband. She says, honey, is everything doing fine? How's my cat? He goes, well, look, I've got something to tell you here. He's some bad news. He said, your cat got out. He got out in the street and a car ran over him and killed him. And she was just kind of shocked. She's like, just like that? I mean, didn't you know you should have watched him? You shouldn't let him just roam out of the house? You know I love that cat. I warned you about this. And now my cat is dead? And she said, on top of it, couldn't you have at least been a little bit more gentle, like maybe made up some story at least at first, like the cat was on the roof, honey, and the cat fell off the roof and got hurt, and I rushed it to the veterinarian, but they couldn't save its life, no matter how hard they tried. I mean, couldn't you have thought of some way to use a little bit more tact? My goodness. She said, well, okay, so the cat's gone. Well, how's mom doing? Well, honey, I got to tell you, your mom was on the roof. Listen, no matter how you present things to certain people, they're not going to receive it well. And this is one of those things where the presentation of Jesus Christ to the people standing there watching the resurrection of Lazarus, it couldn't have been presented any better, and yet they're not going to receive it. They're actually going to reject it. And by the way, this is one of the first things before we even jump into this I want you to know, and that is when people reject Jesus, it is not an intellectual problem. It is not a problem with scientific evidence, as some would claim. It's a heart problem. And you guys know this. People say, well, science has proven, and science this, and science that. I hear that over and over and over. And the bottom line is, guys, science changes so rapidly that they can't even make it from one edition to the next every year at University of Tennessee without making multiple changes. They have to have updates every year. And with science, they have to go back and update it monthly, weekly they have to update it, because there's so many things we're finding out that we're wrong about. We don't know what we're doing. We don't know what we're talking about. We're getting smarter. We're growing. We're learning more. We're adding to the human database, and that's building, and it's good. I'm not downing science. I'm thankful for it. It's wonderful. But science is something that is constantly under correction, because man is flawed and we don't have all the evidence and the upgrades to the science books on a regular basis. Let me ask you a question. How often is the Bible updated? Never. For thousands of years, it's never needed an upgrade. It's never needed a correction. Nobody's ever said, oops, and had to go back and say, well, now we've learned. No, it has proven itself to be 100% accurate for thousands of years, never needing to be changed, because it is the Word of God and the final authority. Science is slowly catching up to the Bible, but it's a slow, long process and will never really attain the perfection of Scripture. And yet, isn't it amazing how people put more trust in science today, oftentimes, than the Word of God? And they'll actually try to say science has proven this and proven that, getting ready for the next change and upgrade for next year. Amazing. The bottom line is God knows what he's talking about. God is the authority. He's the one that we're to look to. And even though it was presented to them, even as the Word of God is presented today in its purity, never being proven to be wrong, always being accurate, people still reject it. And now we see in this situation today a man rising from the dead before their very eyes, and they still are going to reject it. Now, they don't reject that he was risen from the dead, but they are going to reject him as a person, and that's what we get into today. So, again, the setting. Remember, Lazarus has been raised. We're still there at this scene. Last week we ended at the tomb where Lazarus comes out of the tomb, and there's two different groups of people there I want you to note, okay? One group that's going to receive, one group that's going to reject. And this is where a lot of our understanding comes in on when we do ministry, how to deal with people and how people are at heart when it comes to a heart problem. As I said, not an intellectual and or evidence problem. That's not the issue. It comes down to the heart. And that's where we take up in verse 45. Look what it says. This is right after the resurrection. Then many of the Jews who had come to Mary and had seen the things that Jesus did believed in him. But some of them went away to the Pharisees and told them the things Jesus did. Now, don't think they ran to the Pharisees and said, he's so wonderful. You've got to believe in him. They weren't going there to try to be a witness to the Pharisees. Everybody knew. The Pharisees had publicly announced, we hate Jesus, we want nothing to do with him, and anybody that finds him, let us know, we want to arrest him. So this wasn't a let's go to the Pharisees and talk them into it. This was let's go tattletale. You're not going to believe what this guy's doing now. He's raising people from the dead. Is that the most ridiculous? Look at the stunts he'll go to prove that he's the Messiah. Can you believe this guy? Now, I say that again, tongue in cheek, but think about how blind they are. Rather than recognizing right before their very eyes, God in human form doing miracles that no man could ever do, they're trying to find a way to stop him. And guys, it's no different today. People are the same way. You're going to have those that are receptive to the Lord and those that no matter what you show them are going to reject. Now, I don't know if everybody in here this morning knows the Lord. I don't know that. Chances are some of you don't, with this many people here. A lot of you I know do. Chances are some of you don't. And as I present to you the gospel this morning and you hear about Jesus and his love and his miracles, some of you are going to be moved in heart. And if your heart is soft enough, you may receive the Lord today. But there may be somebody here today that says, I don't care what you say. I don't care how persuasive. I don't care if you tell a funny joke and then tie it into the message. I don't care how you present this. I'm just not going to believe. And note this, I'm not going to believe. It is a choice. And you either choose to believe or you choose to harden your heart. And so you have to examine your own heart. And I encourage you, examine your heart as to where you are this morning. First of all, at least admit, which group are you in? Are you in the group that sees of his power, his majesty, and believes? Are you in the group that's going to say, you know what, we need to stop this whole thing. Now, again, I doubt there's very few many people that would come to church and say, I'm here to stop Jesus, so to speak. But at the same time, this is what our society is doing. And so we need to recognize right from the beginning here the difference in these two types of people. One drawn to follow in amazement while others are drawn to opposition and concern. And again, no matter how you present it, it only proves all the more that evidence and miracles do not a believer make. I still think, you know, if only my family, if only my friends, if only the people at work could see a miracle, if only something great could happen, you know, then I would believe. And sometimes people even say, if I could see a miracle, then I would believe. You know, why doesn't God just show people miracles? Because he did, and they still didn't believe. The point is, if we choose not to believe, we're not going to believe regardless of what we see. But if our heart's soft, listen, if your heart is soft for the Lord, you don't need a miracle. You know him. You believe him. But if your heart's hard, a miracle is not going to do anything. Voltaire, many years back, made a comment. He said, you know, if you were to take the ark and drop it in the middle of my hometown street, I would still not believe there was ever an ark. He made up his mind. It doesn't matter what evidence you bring to me. I will not believe. You know, I'm not going to do that. And so this is where these people are in the two different groups. And so then the chief priests, verse 47, and the Pharisees gathered a council. So they gathered some people together. It wasn't the full Sanhedrin. But when they heard of what he was doing, can't believe this guy. He's actually going to raise people from the dead so that people will believe that he's really the Messiah. Huh, let's prove he's not. Yeah, what blindness. They gathered together. And notice they said, what shall we do? For this man works many signs. Now I find it interesting. They couldn't deny the miracles were true. So they're admitting he's doing miracles. They saw the man at Bethesda who was lame that was raised. They saw the blind man who went down to the pool of Siloam that they called before the Sanhedrin. Now they're hearing about Lazarus rising from the dead, and they're saying, this guy's got to be stopped. I mean, what are we going to do with this guy? And again, just the lengths people will go to reject Jesus Christ. He said, if we let him alone like this, everyone will believe in him. That'd be great. And the Romans will come, and here's the real key to this. Notice this. And the Romans will come and take away both our place and our nation. Here's the bottom line. It's about us. We don't want to lose our position. We don't want to lose our power. And we will do anything to stop that from happening. Now, this is rather radical when we look at what they were doing with Jesus and what was right in their face. But we see the same thing in politics today. People will do whatever it takes to stay in power. Certain people will. And again, the Lord knew this. Again, revealing this to us. But how blind and foolish and hard-hearted could they be? Rather than discussing, what they should have done is gotten together and said, can you believe it? I mean, we've seen a lame man walk, the blind seeing, heard about the deaf hearing. We've got Lazarus raised from the dead. All these miracles are happening. Guys, this is the Messiah. It's got to be. How should we present ourselves? Let's call him in. Let's let him know we know he's the Messiah. Let's yield to him. What's his plan? What does he want to do? We're here to follow you. That should have been the natural response to this. But instead, they rejected him. You know, it's interesting. You talk about the millennial kingdom. Jesus is going to come back, the Bible says, and rule and reign for 1,000 years on this earth. Okay, we see that in Ezekiel. We see that in Revelation. We see it throughout the scripture. Here's the amazing thing. It tells us in the scripture that after Jesus ruling and reigning the earth for 1,000 years, which, by the way, only believers are going to be able to enter into that kingdom at that time. So the kingdom will start, the millennial kingdom that you've heard about, 1,000-year reign. It'll begin with Jesus and only believers. But it says that those of us that have been already transferred into our new bodies, that either by the rapture or whatever else, we're going to enter into the kingdom in our new bodies. But people that are here on the earth, when he comes back in the second coming, if they're believers and they get saved after the rapture, they're going to enter into the kingdom in these earthly bodies. So, for example, if somebody here today doesn't know the Lord and the rapture takes place, boom, right now, the Antichrist comes on the scene, God deals with Israel the next 7 years. You make it all the way to the end of the Great Tribulation. You're saved, but you're in a mortal body. Jesus is going to come back. You'll see him come back to the earth. He'll be there to welcome you. You'll enter into the kingdom of God, and you'll be living there with us in our new bodies for that 1,000 years until you die. And that's a whole other teaching. I'm getting way too many different. I'm like those sentences in English that do all this and all the little lines. The bottom line, trust me, God has that worked out. We don't have time to deal with it today. But the bottom line is, the Bible says that those that enter in their mortal bodies, they're still going to be getting married. Now, we're not. Once you enter your new body, we're married to the Lord. But until then, they'll still be marrying and having children, the Bible tells us. And it says that these children will be populating the earth. And what will happen is, here's the amazing thing. After 1,000 years of this and kids being born, there's going to be a large contingent of them who say, we don't want Jesus. We're going to reject him. And the Bible says that at the end of that 1,000 years, he'll once again gather everyone together and judge those who have rejected him, and those who have received him will enter into the kingdom of God. Now, I know what you're thinking right now. How in the world could you live with Jesus for 1,000 years and not believe in him? They did it here. They did it here. They saw his miracles. They saw his glory. They saw his power. And they said, we don't want you. And during the 1,000-year reign, there's going to be some kids that are going to be born. They're going to say, I see your glory. I see your power. And I don't want you. It goes down to a heart issue and a heart decision. By the way, people say, well, you know what? Everybody's really good at heart. And if you just give them the correct environment, everyone will do the right thing. Boy, does the millennial kingdom prove that wrong or what? Because for 1,000 years, you're going to have a perfect environment. No crime, no rape, no murder, no anything. Jesus ruling and reigning the entire earth. And it says people will still say, we don't want you. We choose to reject it. We're going to go an evil way. So it's not environment that makes someone or breaks someone. It can have an effect, absolutely. It's a heart issue. And so Jesus is dealing here with guys that make an amazing admission, and that is, if we don't do something to stop this Jesus, more people are going to believe in him. And really what they should have been saying is, you know what? We need to believe in him. We need to follow him. And how sad it's going to be when they stand before him on that day and face his judgment. Listen, all of us are going to stand before the Lord one day, the Bible says, and face judgment. Now, for believers, we just get judged on our rewards. All you're going to do is welcome, enter in the kingdom. Here's some fun things. Go play, so to speak. But for the unbeliever, why didn't you believe me? Why did you reject me? Why did you turn away? I gave you all these opportunities. I sent all these people to you. I sent you to Calvary Chapel. I sent you to other churches. I was on radio. I was on TV. I sent everything around to you. Why didn't you believe? And at that point, what are we going to say? There's nothing to say. The Bible says every mouth will be stopped. Every man will be silenced. When I get before God, I'm going to tell him. No, you're not. The Bible says all of our guilt will be exposed, and we'll know that we're the ones that are wrong. And it's just going to be up to him to what he does with us. Now, if we receive Jesus Christ, guess what's going to happen? Forgiven. All's forgiven. Everything's gone. What? There's nothing on your record. He's clean other than Jesus Christ, entering the kingdom, the joy of the Lord. But everything that we've done, if we don't know Christ, is written down and we give account for. And because of those judgments, we'll not only not make it into the kingdom of God, but the Bible says we'll be eternally separated from God. It's a big deal. Eternity's a big deal. And so, again, these guys are openly fighting against God. And they foolishly ignore the fact that one day they're going to stand before him and give an eternal account. And they're more concerned, as I said, about their place, and not only their place, but their place in a temporary world as compared to God being the one that really owns it all in eternity. It's not our place at all. Guys, think about it. If you're in any position today, financially, politically, whatever, it's all God's. It's not yours, it's his. He's allowing you to be used in that or blessing you in it in whatever the case might be, but it all belongs to him, and one day he's coming to take it. You know, we're all guests in his creation. Think about it. He's the owner of the home, so to speak, and we're guests in his creation. One day he's coming home, and when he comes home, it's his right to say, this is my house, I'll do whatever I want. I want you here, and you're welcome to be a part of it, but you have to be a part of my family. And that's why we have to make that decision to be a part of the family of God before that day comes. And so how willfully blind they were in rejecting the Lord. And even to think about how directly involved. You know, there's something else I learned this week, guys. I never made the connection. If I had, I'd forgotten about it. I don't know that I had. But I was reading through a harmony of the Gospels. What the harmony of the Gospels is that it gives you all the accounts that happened back to back. It puts the Bible, rather than Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, it blends them all together as one big story. It's wonderful to have. If you don't have one, it's a great way to read through the Gospels and see how everything's linked together. I'd never made the connection. It was after he raised Lazarus and went away for a while, which we're about to read about in a moment, that he heals the 10 lepers. Now, why is that a big deal? Remember the story of the lepers. He runs across these lepers. Lord, have mercy on us. He says, go and show yourself to the priests. and you'll be healed. And here's what's cool. It says, as they went, it was a step of faith. If they heard the word and they had to believe it. As they went, they were healed. And remember, only one of them went back to be thankful. You know the story as far as that goes. Here's the point, though. No one in Israel was ever healed of leprosy. The only other person that was ever healed of leprosy was the one, Jesus. He healed some while he was there. Jesus did. So there may have been more than those 10 Jesus healed lepers, but no other time in history other than when Jesus was there. There's one other time in the Bible, Naaman the Syrian. Remember, he came from Syria. He had leprosy. He came to Elisha. Elisha said, go wash in the Jordan. And he washed in the Jordan. He went back to Syria, cleansed and all this. He wasn't a Jew, so he didn't go to the priest. What is my point in this? There was a ritual you had to do with the priest over a 7-day period to be cleansed of leprosy and to be accepted back into the community. Why is this so huge? They'd seen all these miracles. Lazarus had been raised from the dead. And all of a sudden, get this, the guy they hate, the one they're trying to stop, these 10 guys show up to them because the priests are the ones that had to do it and say, hey, all 10 of us just got healed of leprosy. We need to have you take us through the ritualistic cleansing. And because of the word of God and the political pressure, they would have had to do it. They had to spend 7 days with these 10 guys talking about, everybody talking about it. Jesus sent them there. They were healed. And you can imagine every day going, oh, I have to do these rituals with these guys. We hate Jesus. We want nothing to do with him. But Jesus was in their face in love. Is that great or what? In other words, you know what? You're going to stand before me in judgment one day, but I'm going to give you every opportunity and I'm going to be right there in your face saying, you know what? I love you. And if you would humble yourself and believe in me, I'll give you the kingdom of God. But if not, eternal judgment's on your head. It's not mine. And so those Pharisees had every opportunity to do that. Again, they're coming up on the Passover week here in chapter 11. It's going to be later on we get to the Passover. And although we have quite a few chapters to go in John, this is really the last portion of the Lord's life as far as chronologically. So they're getting ready to go back for the Passover. That's when these 10 lepers would have gone to get prepared ritualistically and cleansed for that Passover where Jesus was going to die on the cross. I mean, the whole connection of this and the intensity of this is amazing. And again, it just shows they had no excuse whatsoever except blatant rejection and blatant refusal to turn to the Lord. And so look what happens. Here, verse 49, it says, and one of them, Caiaphas, being the high priest that year, so he was the official, supposed to be religious leader, although this was a political position by now, he said to them, you know nothing at all. Now, this is funny to me. He says, they know nothing at all. Really, he's the one that knows nothing at all. But he says, you know nothing at all, nor do you consider that it is expedient for us that one man should die for the people. How about that? Wow, really? One man should die for the people, Caiaphas, more than you know. And not the whole nation should perish. Guys, this is very prophetic. And little did Caiaphas know that this was a prophetic statement. He's basically saying, you know what? One man, it's better that one man die than everybody die. And that's exactly what Jesus Christ did on the cross. He died so that we wouldn't have to, so that we can live eternally in the kingdom of God. I did a funeral just last night. And one of the things I always remember in funerals is nobody really died if they're a believer. This person was a believer. He didn't die. He moved. All he did was transfer from this body to the new kingdom. He never died. There's no death at all. We're going to honor him, remember him, praise the Lord for God's faithfulness, and to comfort those that are in sorrow. But we have rejoicing as a believer. And that is that nobody dies. They actually just transfer to another place. He's making this statement. One man needs to die. Jesus Christ died on the cross so that we would never have to die. We could live forever. And God is speaking through Caiaphas prophetically. It's about to tell us in just a moment. And I'm telling you already why. Again, guys, here's my point. Look, God honors positions of authority.
While we're wrapping up our time at the table of God's Word for today, your time in the Bible doesn't have to. In fact, we'd like to encourage you to keep reading. There's so much to learn about Jesus and His love for you and for the world. If you missed any part of this broadcast, or if you want to hear it again, you can by visiting PastorMarkKirk.com. Be sure to subscribe to the podcast too. That way you'll never miss an episode. You can also join us on Facebook to get the latest information on that day's broadcast, along with some inspiration and encouragement for your news feed. There's a link for that too at PastorMarkKirk.com. Now, before we close, let's hand it back over to Pastor Mark one more time.
I'm glad you took the time to join me today to study the Gospel of John. It's such an incredible testimony of Jesus' ministry here on earth.
I hope you've been blessed, and I know I've been blessed teaching it. I'd like to ask you a favor as well. Would you commit to praying during this study through John? Please pray that the Holy Spirit would lead people to this program so that they can find hope in Jesus. And pray that they'd have open ears and soft hearts. I know the message of Jesus can transform lives and heal brokenness, but not if they never hear it. Thanks for lifting your fellow listeners up to the Lord. And thanks for joining me today and every day that we come to the table.
Come to the Table is a radio outreach ministry of Calvary Knoxville.